Thank you. I'm Honza Král. It was supposed to be two of us up here, but unfortunately my colleague Flavio couldn't make it, which is bad because A, he's Italian, so he talks really fast, so I'm not sure how we'll do on time. But it's also good because, like, I can blame everything that goes wrong on him. So thank you, Flavio. So in this talk, I want to talk about, like, what does it take to create an application the right way, with the focus on the DevOps part, on the deploying, how to create your infrastructure, and make sure that you set up yourself for success in the far future. So not like the quick and dirty things that you can do in a day, but something that hopefully won't take that much longer, but will stay with you and with the project for much longer. It is an opinionated talk. I'll be presenting some concrete tools and solutions that work for me, and that's just a personal choice. So the more important part is what I say, why I'm doing some things, not necessarily exactly how, because there are many different tools and people have different experiences, and that is great. So that was some setup, and let's get started. So first, again, some assumptions. So let's say that you want to build a website. You want to build something that you want to share with the world, and this talk is for running it in the real world. So again, nothing quick and dirty, nothing also free, but we'll try to keep the cost as down as possible. The idea is that this is, again, setting yourself up for long term, so not something that you would do for a project that you want to just have up over the weekend and then tear it down. This is more for something how I believe projects should be run when you need them to be alive and when you want to build upon them and expand them. So like if you're starting a new project in your company or your personal project or something like that, or just want to learn how things are done. So there are some disclaimers that, well, so far that's all the things I've been doing, but there are definitely easier ways how to do this. Both those that are compromising on some of the things I deem important, but also just some that you might have something already prepared by a third-party library or a framework. This talk is more about this is how it works underneath and how it's done. If you can jumpstart three steps out of five that I described by using a freely downloadable template or something like that, 100% go for it. And hopefully this talk will give you the tools to determine whether that's a good thing or a bad thing, what you're about to do. And last disclaimer, I promise, and that is before you start writing an application, think twice whether you need it. These days, when you have things like GitHub pages, when you have static site generators, when you have all of these things, you can get by with no code or very little code for a lot of use cases out there. You can usually cobble something together with freely available components and services that will run them for you, either for free or for some small amount. So always keep that in mind, that should always be your first option. The best code is no code at all. I think that's kind of obvious. So now let's get started. So we are starting a fresh project. So first we need to do is create some code. For me, if you don't know, or if you're on the verge what to use for a web application, et cetera, that means that the answer is Django. It is the default for a reason. It has the most resources out there. It is the most common denominator in the Python world, at least. So if you're unsure, if you don't know 100% sure that you want to use, Flask or something else, use Django. That's the easy part. Now, what other parts are we gonna need? So we're gonna need to set up the local development. So first we're gonna need something to install Django or something like that. I use Poetry to do that, but again, so many other tools, and pretty much for the use case that we're talking about, all of them work just fine. So again, just use something that works personally for you. The reason why I chose poetry, the why that you should remember, is it does two important things for me. It allows me to track dependencies exactly with a pinned version, and it allows me to keep it clean. So if I remove a dependency, it will remove everything that sort of came with it. And it's much easier to manage these things, because those are sort of first class citizen commands in the poetry ecosystem. That's why I chose poetry. But again, your mileage may vary, and just do something that will do these things for you, allow you to very easily add and remove dependencies. Probably touch something, my apologies. So the other part we're gonna need is we're gonna need some configuration. So in this case, it's pretty easy. I will stick to the sort of simplest thing possible, which is environment variables. So whenever you're creating a configuration for your Django project or anything else, just stick in the values that will work for you locally, and allow it to be overridden in production by setting environment variables. You can do it manually, as I specified here, or there are plenty of tools that will do that for you. They are more or less sophisticated, depending kind of on your taste. Me personally, I'm a very simple person. This works for me super well, because everybody can see what it's doing. Some people prefer nice abstractions, etc. There was a talk about Pydantic and other tools that can serve for this purpose as well. But it just depends on your kind of appetite for complexity versus having something ugly like this in your code. And when I said you should default for the local environment, there is one exception to that. Whenever there is something that deals with security or debugging or anything like that, the default should be off. So that's just one thing. You should never ever have to deal with the problem of accidentally deploying something in production in debug mode with whatever tool you're using. So make sure that that's the one exception where you need to override it very explicitly when developing locally, so that to prevent accidents in the future. And then there are some tools. And I put them here at the beginning of the talk, because I think that this is something that you should do first, is make sure that all of the good things that you're trying to do will stay good. So something to keep you honest. And also, just basically for the psychological effect of things, it's much easier to add things to an already existing tooling or whatever compared to introducing a new tool. So that's why I like every new project to start with pre-commit installed and configured for my favorite linter formatter and also tests running. Even if you just put a dummy test that asserts that 1 + 1 = 2, that's a great test to have there, because it's so much easier to add another test when you're comparing it to, oh, now I need to introduce testing and do some bootstrapping or something like that. No, make sure that all of it is there from the very beginning, even if it's just dummy things. This will help you keep things clean as you go. And also, don't trust yourself that you're going to run it. Make sure that there is an independent party, in this case, a CI, a continuous integration tool. In my examples, I would use GitHub, because that's probably the most common one, that will run it as well. That will give you two major benefits. First is the obvious: even if you forget to run tests and you push some code, it will still get run. And second, it will verify your setup. It will verify that the dependencies, for example, that you have are sufficient, that you haven't accidentally installed something without committing it into the code, so it will not get transferred to the new environment. So those are the two major benefits, even when you're working alone, to have CI. Once you add other people, well, then it's even more beneficial. And nowadays, adding CI is not a big investment. with GitHub, all you need to do is create a file like this. So this is everything that you need to do to run pre-commit as configured in your local configuration, the way you use it locally on GitHub. You just need these three predefined actions and you're done. It is not complicated. If you want to add another job to run your Python tests, PyTest is my library of choice with Django. There is PyTest Django. Again, pretty obvious. It says what it does what it says on the tin. And this is how you run it. This is even a more sort of complete example. It even runs a database for you. So this is pretty much enough for 99% of the applications out there already. And you can get this done in a few hours, even if you're completely fresh. You just Google how to do Django tests in GitHub Actions or PyTests or something like that, and you come up with that. Not to mention that all of these commands are something that you should be familiar with, because that's what you had to do locally to get the tests running. So there is really no excuse to not have these things, and they will set you up for a peace of mind, because now you know that whatever happens, these things, linting, code formatting, testing, etc., you'll never have to think about it again. It's there, it's your safety net. So when you add things, all you have to do is add the test, configure a new linter, for example, if you introduce new file format, or if you discover that something doesn't work for you really well. Again, it's much simpler to add and tweak things as opposed to introduce entirely new concepts. So that's why I say that it's nice to have this done before you start any coding. That allows you, again, two things. I like to say that everything benefits in two ways, but you can really subdivide it any way you like. First is like what I described, like this is now the project setup, and now I can switch my mind. Okay, and now I'm thinking about application and I'm done with that stuff. So there is a mental clarity that, yeah, I don't have to worry about this. And also, because this is done before any application code, you can reuse this. You can then save this as a template and reuse it. Or, more realistically, you can find a template that already does all of these things. This is how I would judge a good template when I'm looking for like how to start a Django project. Does it have all of these things? Does it allow me to do all the things that I mentioned, all the benefits? Does it give me the peace of mind? Is there a place where I can just add another test without having to figure out anything? So this is where we are at the beginning of the project. Now we can write some code, and usually that starts with an important question: where and how are we going to store our data? Typically, we need a database. That's the established default in the industry. Everybody tells you, every tutorial that you read for Django or for anything else, yeah, this is how you start a project, this is how you bootstrap your database. It even assumes that the database is going to be a relational database. That might be the case, but again, you have to think about it. Oftentimes, maybe the files don't change, maybe the data don't really change that frequently, and they only come from a certain sources, like from you, maybe. At that point, probably a YAML file in the same Git repo is much easier than having to have a database and manage a moving part. Maybe I just need a few counters or something like that, and Redis would be much simpler than having a full-fledged relational database, which is a very complex piece of software. So always think, what is it that you need? And when thinking about this, think about how are you going to use it? Many people fall into the trap that they try to model the data and say, okay, so I have these entities and they have these attributes and this is what the data is. I don't care. I care about what you want to do with the data. What are the queries that you want to run? What are the operations that you want to perform? and then choose your database, and then design your schema accordingly to make your life easier. You, unless you're writing this for like a school project on database design, nobody cares whether you're using first normal form or third. It's some useful principles are definitely there and you should be familiar with it, but ultimately what happens, what matters is how are you going to use this data and how what will make your life easier. Be lazy. That's ultimately what the job is. So once you select a database, or hopefully not, you need to run it somehow locally first. So for this, Docker is your friend, and in particular, Docker Compose, because it allows you to kind of grab something, and nowadays every pretty much database or service or anything like that will come with a pre-built Docker container that you can just grab and run and configure it super, super easily. And all you have to do is create a Docker Compose for those dependencies that you have. So this would be my example, where I'm just running Postgres, I'm running Redis, and that's it. Notice one important thing. I'm not running my Python code in there. This is purely for the dependencies. For Python code, I still prefer to run that manually in my virtual environment, just on the command line or from your IDE. It makes things so much easier because you don't have to deal with another layer of abstraction that you don't really need for development. You just develop locally, and you just have these services up there through the Docker Compose. If something goes wrong, your database gets into an unknown state or something, just kill the Docker Compose and start it back again, clean slate. It will work for tests, it will work for some of your manual testing, but not so well. It won't work really well if you're used to testing and developing things while looking at the browser or something like that. To me, that's a feature because it will kind of force you to do things the right way, which is just use tests, just use repeatable code as opposed to doing things manually. That's why we created computers in the first place, so that we don't have to do things manually. Use it. So that's it. Now we're done developing. We've created our setup. We've created our feedback loop with the tests, with the Docker Compose, and we wrote all our code. And now we're ready to go live. We're ready to share something with the world and make sure that it stays there. So how do we go about that? So first thing that we need to do is we need to create some infrastructure. And just like with the test, just like with anything else, we want to do that through code. We never want to do anything manually. It might sound, and when I show you the examples, it might look overwhelming, and there's definitely a lot of things there. But it's usually roughly the same complexity as trying to figure out where to click in the Cloud Console UI or something like that, and it is repeatable, and most importantly, it is iterable. Because you can kind of start with a small thing, with the first example that you find somewhere, copy from some slides or download somewhere from the internet, and then you can gradually improve on it and just keep running it over and over again until it gets good. And you never kind of are in that situation where you don't really know how things got where they are, and you don't know what the next step is, because it's just code. You can iterate on it, you can test it, You can validate it, you can do all of these things. You can cooperate on it in the future. So for me, the weapon of choice for there is Terraform. Again, there are many other options. I like Terraform because it's, again, the default. As I said, I'm a simple person. Terraform is the default. It will have support for any kind of services and tools that you decide to use, and you don't have to think about it too much. If you ever will need help or hire somebody, chances are it will be much easier to find somebody with Terraform knowledge. Then we need some of the services, the databases, etc. I think this one is pretty clear. You don't want to run your database. That's not your job if you're in this talk. you want to develop your application, you want to deal with the idea, you don't want to babysit a database. That's just what we developed, you know, services for. That's why we have Google. Otherwise, what's the point? So just use the pre-built services. Again, you can use Terraform to manage them. We'll see how that works. And finally, for your code, Docker is the perfect vessel. We're kind of past like dealing with virtual machines and running things yourself. You just package things up and hand it over to something that understands how to run a container. That was the entire idea behind them in the first place, and that's what we're going to use. One kind of technical point here. Throughout all of this process, all you have to keep in mind is whenever you see something that's potentially sensitive, like a password, it should never ever be written anywhere, and you should never ever see it. That sounds counterintuitive. How do I work with something that I don't see? We'll see. Ha. Okay, so this is an example for Terraform, for working with GCP with the Google Cloud. Again, you can work with any other cloud. It will be very analogous. For me, I'm now familiar with Google Cloud. And this is like the basic setup. I'm creating a Google project. I'm creating a database instance, quite a small one in this case. And that's the beauty of Terraform. If I find out in the future that I need it to be bigger, I'll just change that one value from F1 micro to F1 super, super extra large. I'll end up paying more money, but I'll have a bigger instance, and Terraform will do all of that for me. And I'm creating a database, and you can see that I'm just referring and as a variable to the instance where I want the database created. And speaking of secrets, this is how you would do it. You ask Terraform to generate you a random password. Then you refer to it when you're creating the database user, and then you store it in a Google secret store. So you're telling Google, here, I have a secret. I want you to keep it safe for me and also use it to create this database user. And then when you're handing your container over to something that will run it for you, you say, oh, and there is a secret that you have in storage for me. I want you to expose it to this container under the name database_password. So it will be there as the environment variable, but as you can see, we've never seen it once. It will never be written in any file, and that's a good thing. Agreed? Awesome. And by the way, yeah, Cloud Run is the Google's alternative for the service where you just hand it a container and it will run it. It's that simple. It's what Google does. So, all good there. And now we just need to wrap it all up. So we need one command to kind of do all of this, because we need this to be easy. We need to be this to be so easy that we can run it several times an hour. Every time you reach to a state that works, you should feel absolutely safe and comfortable just deploying and pushing it out. Again, to get you into the pattern of pushing often, as opposed to putting things off and saying, oh, I'm not sure whether this fully works and I don't want to go through the trouble of deploying it because I might have to change something. No, if that's your thinking, that's a clear signal that you've done something wrong, probably. Because this process should be effortless. You should always feel perfectly free to just say, yeah, deploy. It should take a few minutes at most. And that's how you know that your system works. When you feel very comfortable, essentially every time you do a git push, you will do a deploy as well. This would be the script in our example. It's really this simple. You build the Docker image, you push it into the registry, you run the Terraform apply, and then you update the Google Cloud Run. In once everything is set up in Google, so after you've run this once, you can actually skip the Terraform apply because that's the part that will take the longest. that's the one that creates all the databases or makes sure that they're up to date and all of these things. So that's typically only has to be run once, or then after you change anything in your Terraform. So you can then kind of comment it out or have two different commands, one for the initial setup and one for then just the deploy. And with the Docker build push and the gcloud run, it should really not take longer than a minute or two. And it is not super complicated. Would you agree? Awesome. So notice that I've kind of omitted a few things here. So first is kind of staging environment. Usually you want to have two different environments. One where you test things and experiment things, or you want to maybe share with somebody features that are not yet ready for prime time. There is a reason why I felt comfortable skipping it, because it's easy. When we have everything in code, then we can run the code twice and get two different environments. All we need to do is define some variable that will declare the domain or the project name or something like that to keep them separate. But I could do just the same thing just by specifying two different sets of credentials for like two different Google accounts, for example, and just run the same code. That's the major benefit of having the infrastructure as code, because not only can you iterate on things, but you can also then parameterize them and have multiple environments or use the same code for multiple different projects. And it being code, it just does that. You can just define a variable, pass it in from the command line and say, oh, now I want to go into that environment and that region. And I want to use that Docker image with that application. It's just as simple as defining a variable, which as programmers, we're all very familiar with. So all of the benefits of code work here. The simplest way to do it is to just parameterize the deploy sh file and make sure that it knows what to do and where to do it. Now to address the elephant in the room. Usually when we're talking about deployment, it's you know, the unwritten law that somebody will mention Kubernetes sooner or later. No. So Kubernetes is something that other people use to build the services that you then use. Unless you're in that business, in which case, I don't know what you're doing in this talk, like you don't need Kubernetes. It is way too complicated, it is way too low level, and it is just, no. Please. Like every time you use Kubernetes to deploy a Python application, there is a kitten that dies somewhere, I'm sure. This deserves like a few more no's, because like this is important, and I don't know for what reason it became like this idea that, you know, Kubernetes is the way how you deploy things. No. Everybody clear on this? Thank you. Okay. So then what happens next? What happens when you want to add more people to the team, or you want to automate things even further? Well, we have a word for that, and that's continuous delivery. So we already mentioned CI, continuous integration. So this is the other two letters, this in the CI/CD acronym. So continuous delivery is where you automate even your deploy.sh script. That's really all it would take in this case. And it would be really simple, because all we have to do is take those three commands that we had in the deploy.sh and put them into a GitHub action. We already know how to do that because we've done that for pre-commit, we've done that for our tests. And all it will need is some credentials to make sure that it can communicate with Google to to do the deploy, to upload the image and all of these things. And we know how to do those things as well, because we just use a secret. So we would manually upload a secret into GitHub, and then we would be able to use it in the GitHub action so that the GitHub action can run with the appropriate privileges to do all that is needed. So that would be a great step when you decide to add another person to your development team, because then you don't have to worry about who runs the deploy and when and from what state. Because otherwise it can happen that somebody will run it, but maybe they haven't updated to the latest version, they haven't pulled your latest change or something like that. There might be some miscommunication, there'll just be concurrency issues where two people are trying to deploy at the same time, etc. Just not worth it. There is no reason to communicate with that other person. You know, just deal with computers. That's what we do. You know, computers over people, right? No. But in this case, yes. Because it makes it easier, and when we're communicating to humans, we can focus on the important stuff. Not, can I deploy now? Do you have you pulled everything? No. Nobody wants to have that conversation. It's boring. And finally, what's next? Once you have all of these things, what are the next steps in your long-running project? Well, the first one is backups. Make sure that everything is, that you have all of the things. Luckily, due to us using infrastructure as code, all you really need is the data, because you can recreate everything else. You have a script to do that. You have one command that you can run that will create everything from scratch. So you're safe there. If Google in Europe goes down, you can just change one variable to US East to run in the US region in Google Cloud and run the same command, and it will recreate everything there. All you need is then to populate the data. So make sure you have the data. It's as simple as that. Typically, all of the services that we talked about using, like Cloud SQL, will have options to have automated backups. Use them and verify them. Make sure that you go through this exercise at least once every year to make sure that A, it works, and B, you know how to do it. Because you don't want to be trying to figure this out on a Sunday afternoon when you want to desperately be doing something, anything else. So that's not a conducive, you know, environment to learning how to restore from a backup. Make sure that that's second nature to you and that's documented somewhere. You also want to have monitoring to even know that something happened. Usually, for the first few years of a project, it's fine to just have an external monitoring service that will tell you whether the system is still up. That's it. And if it's not, you want to know why it isn't up. So use some error reporting, maybe some APM in the future, some logging, etc. I believe that there are a few companies here who do that, like Sentry and others, which again is a free service for smaller accounts, or you can run it yourself, but typically you don't want to. So this would be the steps to do, to kind of make sure that once you're live, you will also stay live. So that was pretty much it. A little light on the concrete examples, because we had to oversimplify a lot of things, but the general principles remain. Stick to the philosophy of everything should be repeatable and iterable, so that you can start small and build on top of it. But you will never have to kind of stop and redo everything. It will just always be another small step. And you will have tools that will help you make that step. If you want to add a replica to your database, you just add one more resource into your Terraform, run Terraform apply, and it will happen. You don't need to figure out how to do it. If you want to resize your database, if you want to suddenly have multiple different deployments, you can do, again, the same thing and just run Terraform apply, and it will do it. If you want to move from this to something the size of, you know, millions of users and all these things, there is a clear path. You will never have to kind of scrap everything and start over. So this is really setting you up for success, and it highlights always what the next step is. You should never be like, okay, now I don't know what to do. I need to get there and I don't know how. No, with this approach, you should always know how or be able to figure it out. So thank you so much. And now we'll have some time for questions.
Thank you, Honza. Please use the microphones to ask the questions. We have a few time.
Thank you for your talk, very interesting. I would like to ask you about logging. Have you any advice about good practice, how to manage logging in production? Because sometimes it's a little bit tough to find useful information in logs. Thank you.
Yes. I have unlimited amount of information on logging. That's my specialty. I try to stay away from it, but so make sure that the logs are captured somewhere. And they're not stored in files, but they're stored in somewhere else. In our example with using Cloud Run, et cetera, they will automatically be collected by Google, and you will see them there. You might have to configure that. Again, you can do that using the same Terraform file. And it will be there, you will have an interface and you will have a search. So you can search through them. The most important part is that how you generate those logs and what kind of information you put into it. The best advice that I can give you there is always add structure to your logs and context. So use a struct log or some other library that allows you to do structured logging and play a little bit around it and just make sure that your logs are in JSON or some other parsable format so that you can work with it. Again, you can do this in an iterative approach. First version would be just set everything up at the very beginning so that you can do structured logging. That should be in your template, again, before you start touching application code. And then you know that there is a path forwards. So first, it will just be locally in a file in your Cloud Run. It will be in the Cloud Console, and you can log there and search through it. When you grow even further, you can start parsing the logs and creating dashboards based on those structured data into it and alerts and things like that. Even further down the line, you can then capture it into some system like Elasticsearch, the ELK stack, or anything else. Again, tools like Sentry or Datadog will allow you to do the same thing. The primary aspect is you need to know what you're logging, why, and that it contains all of the information that is relevant. Not just, you know, oops, something happened. But this particular thing happened, and this was what I was trying to do, and these are the parameters, and this is the time of day, and, you know, this is the phase of the moon right now. All of the information. Make sense? Awesome. More questions?
Yeah. Good talk, actually. You covered pretty much everything from start to end up to going to live. So really good talk. Just one question. You mentioned about storing secrets as GitHub secrets. When a new developer joins in, it's easy for them to, like, you know, run through the GitHub workflow. But we had a problem. So say, for example, I'm in the development team and I'm adding the GitHub secret. The new developer comes in, they don't have to bother about anything, they run it. But when I leave, the secret remains secret. So we weren't able to extract that secret from the GitHub because we can add it, but we can't retrieve it. How would you solve that problem, actually? Any suggestions on that?
I would not. and the reason for that is, to me, secrets are write-only. I never want to read a secret as a person. If something like that happens, you leave and somebody else, they should just create a new secret and replace the one that was there without trying to retrieve it. So again, ideally I would have something that would generate that secret for me and push it there without anybody seeing it. But even if it's just a copy paste for one time setup, I'll allow it. But yeah, don't try to recover the secret. and just create a new one, because that's better anyways, because you want to rotate them in case something leaks, especially when a person leaves. Like, that secret should no longer be valid, because that should be tied to the person who created it.
But the project might have, like, you know, 20 or 30 having, like, AWS roles and other things which are responsible. Not always we can rotate it, isn't it?
Well, that's why you want to automate that. That's why you want to have it as code, so you will be able to rerun it or update it and not worry about these things. For example, like when we create GitHub secrets, etc., like, it's also run from Terraform, which will create like a service account in Google, generate the key, and push it into GitHub without anybody ever seeing it. So it should be independent, and it's a secret. Oh, sorry, it's a secret like any other. It's not special, and it should not be treated that way. Like, if in doubt, kill it, replace it. Don't worry about it. It's not a person. It's fine.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure.
Hi, thank you for the call or talk. I would like to ask about one little detail notice about pre-commit hooks, because I liked to use pre-commit hooks, but lately I've been noticing that they are doing more harm than they are good for, and especially when I noticed that where you were setting up the CI, you are actually running a pre-commit hook. So unless you are actually pushing to main, is there any benefit of running a pre-commit hook?
Always. So first, running it, you mean running it locally? Yeah. So you want to shorten the feedback loop. You don't want to push something and then figure it out later that it's wrong when you've already switched to something else. You want to get that feedback as soon as possible that something is not ideal, and you want to do it before anybody else sees it. Because that will be just like, so I push something where the pre-commit doesn't work. Let's say I messed up the formatting or something like that. And I don't want anybody to have to go back and say, okay, no, that's wrong, you need to fix it. We should not have that conversation as people. That's, again, delegate that to the machines. And you want to do that as soon as possible so that the feedback loop is as short as possible. So you avoid sort of mind switching and task switching and doing something else. It should be, that's why you run it locally. That makes sense? Awesome.
Thank you for the talk. The question, do you have a public repo with all this in one, like some kind of templates that can be reused?
No, I don't. That's a good question. There are plenty of other examples out there. Honestly, I didn't have the time I wanted to. But a lot of that is also super opinionated and wouldn't be super useful. But for things like the for Django, for example, the cookie cutter that you can find out there is pretty advanced. It does even a lot more things that I didn't even go into. So always just. There are tools already out there. I was focusing more on the principles here.
Which example was it that you made?
Yeah, Django Cookie Cutter. So Cookie Cutter is a library for, or is a tool for using templates for projects and for other things. And it was created by two Django people. So the Django Cookie Cutter, which is a template for new Django projects, is actually quite nice and has a lot of features. It doesn't. Yeah, that is true. That's just for the Django part. But again, if you just Google like Terraform, Django, Cloud Run, you will find a lot of things. But that's just an excuse. I know. I didn't have time. I apologize. True.
We have time for a last question.
Yes, you showed how to create a deploy SH and have all the code, all the infrastructure as code. And then you subtly mentioned that after the first time you should delete the Terraform apply. Is there a better way to like check if that's already done? Is it like idempotent, or does that term apply in infrastructure? How does that work?
Good question, thank you. No, the Terraform reply is idempotent. You can keep running it. I mentioned that you can kind of omit it to save time. So what I typically did in that situation was I would have a single if around it. It says like, if not initial, then skip it. And if fast deploy flag is turned on, skip it and do that. And I would use that like if I need to deploy a hotfix or something like that. But you should be able to always run the Terraform reply, and it should tell you nothing to do. And that's a good thing. Thank you. So thank you so much. If you have any more questions, I'll be around. And thanks.